Well, good evening, Vice Chancellor, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you very much for making the time to come and join me here tonight. It's certainly one of the most significant moments in my academic life and professional life. Just a little note for those of you who will come here after me. Let me tell you, this is not an easy task to make. And indeed, as we all think, this might be the time when your bright future might be judged. So I would like to start my inaugural by trying to reflect on a few myths and misconceptions about travel and tourism. Firstly, there seems to be a belief that, as my colleague John Panzer from the World Bank once told me, travel and tourism are everybody's business. If you sat on a beach deck chair at least once in your life, you must be an expert. And he had written that on a piece of scrap paper during one of our missions in Swaziland while we were on an expert consortium advising the Swazi government on a number of sectors. Each expert had been listening in religious silence to every specialist's case for agriculture, mining, manufacturing, retailing. But when tourism came along, somehow 9 out of 9 experts felt entitled to provide professional advice on how tourism should or could be developed in the country. So, the thing is that generally, when we talk and think about travel and tourism, it often invokes imagery of places like beaches, natural reserves, cultural sites, possibly holiday resorts, iconic sceneries, airports, luxury hotels, and much more. We tend not to think somehow about space politics, social justice, gender equality, poverty alleviation, environmental management, or even impact that epidemics or conflicts may inflict on destinations. And more today, more than ever, as Western consumers, we often ignore mobility rights and only acknowledge this as an issue when somehow, suddenly, our right to travel is hindered by a nativist or populist political climate pushing for questionable travel bans based on nationality or, worse, religious belief. So it is, of course, as a human geographer with a background in economics and a keen interest in development studies, geography has been pretty much at the center of my personal and professional life. And it has been an integral part of my journey, because tonight I will be talking about my own journey. The journey from my Erasmus days, when my father took me to the airport on the day I was coming here for the very first time in 1994 as an Erasmus student, to then take permanent residency in 2001. And I think on this very day, I feel proud to say that I'm actually a product of the European Union. Indeed, I came to this country as an exchange student and later become an expert in international tourism policy, planning, and development. So they call me these days. Geography is indeed about the world, how humans relate to each other, and of course, the environment in which they operate. We are concerned with spatial patterns and distributions, and it's somehow logical for tourism geographers like me to be interested in how tourism develops, what it means for people and places, and what these patterns may be in the future. We are indeed also interested in how people become more mobile and what mobility means. In the context of travel and tourism, why people go to certain places, what physical features may attract them, and how and what needs to be done in order to preserve those physical features in the first place attracted visitors. So at the question, what does a professor of tourism and international development professors? Although there are a lot of people which genuinely struggle with the idea that I've got nothing to do with organizing holidays. In fact, I'm pretty useless at that. My response is that if of holidays we want to talk, or maybe travel and tourism may be more accurate, I spend my time looking how to make sure that some destination, some of the most remote and complex one, can become a holiday destination or a business travel destination. So working out ways, for instance, in which destination can be developed and managed in a more sustainable manner by identifying fairer host-guest model of transactions and minimizing the environmental impact associated with travel and tourism interventions. Sustainability has guided most of my journey. Dating back to my undergraduate research in 1995, when I got involved in questioning the sustainable development oxymoron, with particular attention to the sustainability of the socioeconomic diversification process proposed for the rural periphery of Paris, in preparation to what later became Disneyland Paris. My PhD journey soon followed and spent the next 3 years studying the effect of the European Union agricultural policy on the Apulia region of Italy and the West Country of Great Britain, which, with my research, gently diverting into critical elaborations of rural diversification processes into tourism system modeling and into what today is commonly referred as to rural tourism. In September 2002, 2 years after completing my PhD, having spent my immediate postdoctoral period teaching 22 hours a week at the Birmingham College of Food and Tourism, I came here to Brighton as a senior lecturer. And an all different story began. On day 3 of my employment at Brighton, I was writing my first grant application for funding from the Southeast Development Agency. And to my great surprise, after 2 weeks, I got a reply saying that I'd been granted my first research project. And of course, at that particular time was for me the point where I had to start carving my academic identity. And I established a research specialist group called Sustainable Tourism in Local Economies. And of course, coming from Italy, the acronym of that is STYLE. That one was within the Center of Tourism Policy Studies, for which we managed to secure the affiliate membership of the United Nations World Tourism Organization. We were, in fact, the first research institutions to secure that. My mission, as David said earlier, became to generate new knowledge on ways in which tourism can play a key role in sustainable development by stimulating local economies, conserving the environment, developing people, and changing lives. And although acknowledging the contested nature of the sustainable tourism concept, this has really much played a key role in most of my work, reflecting very much my commitment to research and teaching that contributes to the creation of a more just and environmentally sustainable society. My interest in rural development has also guided most of my research in Europe, Asia, and Africa. As a vehicle to rural diversification, facilitating local communities' development and gender equality, I have researched bottlenecks, dilemmas, and challenges faced by those destinations seeking to achieve development through tourism. With travel and tourism being responsible for 9.8% of the global GDP and growing on an average of 4% yearly for the next 10 years, we see more than 1 billion travelers traveling around the world, in addition to 1 billion more domestic travelers. In such context, the integrity of the destination we visit becomes paramount to tourism, both in terms of its long-term survival and validity, with action needed for the preservation of its resources by, for example, accelerating travel and tourism transition to a low-carbon future and by responsibly facing disruptions such as terrorism and political unrest. Globally, travel and tourism are increasingly portrayed as able to contribute to sustainable development, whatever that means. And international development agencies, national and regional development bodies, private and third sector organizations see tourism as an important tool for socioeconomic development, cross-cultural integration, peace building, and environmental preservation. However, despite their many benefits, my research showed that their development comes with a number of complications, which have been the core of my work funded by institutions such as the World Bank, the UN, and the European Union. Soon after visiting Namibia in 2003, after being invited by one of our former students, the African continent became the preferred location of my funded research in the years that followed. I creatively used international development agency funding not only to deliver the project for which I had secured the funding, but also to source a number of publications and outputs which later became the basis of my submission to the research exercise frameworks, the REE, the REF 2014, and no doubt will be part of the next research exercise assessment. Taking a central theme, the debate on whether tourism should be used in development efforts, much of my work has been examining the way in which tourism has controversially become the way forward to development in some of the most complex locations in sub-Saharan Africa. As David highlighted, I developed my own research frameworks based on a number of qualitative, participatory, and cross-disciplinary techniques, in particular, the peer-to-peer proactivist and impact-oriented collaborative approach based on co-constructed research techniques, enhancing the contribution of those who would normally belong to voiceless groups. I am told that my research has been instrumental in providing new elaborations on tourism as a tool to development as at macro and micro level, and underpinning the agenda of many interventions and by key donors like, as David mentioned, the World Bank, UNESCO, and UNIDO, in some very difficult settings, such as post-conflict destinations like Burundi, Rwanda, and Sierra Leone, or peripheral areas of Namibia, Malawi, and the Gambia. For instance, my work on tourism in post-conflict situation of fragility, published in Annals of Tourism Research, provided empirically grounded advancement to the discourse of post-conflict development through tourism. This became a term of reference by local senior officials in their negotiations for international donors' assistance, as well as the implementation of national tourism development measures in Burundi as much as in other countries in the region. This also became instrumental to my invitation as advisor more recently to the East Africa Tourism Platform on issues such as multi-destinations product development and mobility rights, which have recently seen fruitions in the implementation of a univisa between Kenya, Uganda, and Rwanda, and their joint tourism marketing effort, which were well visible at the last World Travel Market in London, and most recently March at the ITB in Berlin. In late 2014, during a World Bank mission in the Gambia, I became exposed to the implication of the Ebola virus disease epidemic, which have been devastating for several countries across Africa, not necessarily directly affected by the Ebola epidemics. The Ebola-induced tourism crisis in the region became the focus of a critical piece of collaborative work, which contributed to the broader debate on the threat of epidemics on tourism, providing reflection on developing national plans aimed at stimulating a shift recovery process, but most importantly, enhancing tourism systems resilience. This research has also recently become the basis of my involvement with the government of Sierra Leone in funding responsible and innovative ways forward to revive and restructure the tourism sector in the country. When preparing my inaugural, I tried to find aspects of my research which would touch upon most significant milestones of my academic career and, of course, my academic identity. And beyond the work in Africa, which was collated recently in my publication earlier mentioned by David, my subject contribution and academic identity is certainly associated with the concept of niche tourism. My applied research revealed new insights into necessity for the shift from the 20th to the 21st century conceptual framing of tourism planning paradigms, which place close attention to rapidly changing macro and micro contexts in which the tourism sector operates. 12 years ago, I proposed niche tourism as a more sustainable alternative to the well-traversed mass tourism sector. To date, I have researched niche tourism from three different perspectives: market segmentation, product diversification, and more recently, regional development and inclusive growth, especially within the African continent. Primarily associated with the expansion and diversification of tourism motivation, consumption, and production patterns beyond mass tourism, niche tourism was segmented into a set of macro and micro niches, highlighting a move from commodified mainstream type of tourism into one that is tailor-made, unique, and entwined into a multifaceted set of experiential, culture-specific, and activity-based form of tourism. Niche tourism has become a widely adopted terminology, in both in terms of segmentation of tourism and tourism policy, but most importantly, in destination marketing terms. In terms of sustainability, illusion of not, niche tourism has proved to play a key role in market diversification, inclusive growth, and sustainable tourism development in some of the most peripheral locations in the world. In today's volatile economic climate, changing behavior by consumers have an increasing impact on global commerce. The speech that I'm giving today is very much linked to my work, my grounded work and my applied research. So the speed of market change, the blurring of traditional demographic boundaries, the growing power of consumer through technology and the nature of globalization are indeed practically making the trends determination far more complex. And of course, their actual exploitation far more essential in making sure that a successful tourism sector may take place. This is particularly important in travel and tourism when it comes to the selection of travel goods and services and in terms of living the experience. It's not a new fact that consumers are different and increasingly discerning of the product and service they buy, and a recent report by ABTA clearly highlighted that. They are more and more tech-enabled and more time-pressured, so they have less and less time in which they can make decisions, but higher and higher expectations that those decisions prove to be right. So destinations and national tourism organization face significant challenges in making sure that these needs are addressed. In recent years, niche tourism has occupied an ambiguous position in the regional development discourse and practice. In many developing and emerging destinations, while mainstream tourism has often been sidelined to give priority to sectors such as agriculture, manufacturing, or knowledge-intensive activities, niche tourism has been increasingly positioned as the great development hope for peripheral regions and as a potential driver in the development of new urban and rural areas experience economy. The growth of low-cost carriers like EasyJet, Ryanair, AirAsia, FastJet have facilitated air access to secondary airports and the entry of niche tourism destinations into the global tourism market. On the other hand, climate change has posed some critical questions on the sustainability of travelling by air. Digital innovations, such as, for instance, collaborative and sharing economy, like many of you will know Airbnb or Uber, have created new local and regional development opportunities as much as policy challenges. In fact, as critics maintain, the sharing economy associated with travel, tourism, and hospitality may deliver unfair competition, may diminish job security, may condone tax avoidance, and may present a threat to safety, health, and disability compliance standards, defeating the ambition to operate in a more sustainable and responsible manner. So within the last two decades, post-materialistic new concerns over the consumption of goods and tourism have emerged. New consumers have emerged. They are living in economies where their basic needs are quickly and easily satisfied, and they increasingly tend to reject mass-produced and mass-marketed commodities in favor of product and services that can claim to be somehow more authentic and more sustainable than others. The perception of authenticity depends on each individual cultural background, set of values, and experiences. Equally, though, sustainability awareness depends upon similar characteristics and also have a huge impact on individual choices. And like any other form of tourism, in a way, niche tourism can contribute towards the conservation and revival of traditions. So in terms of using authenticity and sustainability to move local culture forward in the future, people continue to pass them on to the next generation as tourism product. And questionable or not, this makes some of the local authentic features being passed from generation to generation. On the other hand, while the old mass international tourism model based on industrial operating principles has been successful and has supported considerable growth, it is producing questionable returns for providers and communities involved. It is criticized for placing excessive pressure on scarce physical and cultural resources, and it is failing to take sufficient responsibility for actively managing its impact on the resources on which it depends. In such context, niche tourism has, in some cases, just become an additional exploitative strategy, and a move towards targeting a diverse portfolio of customers with little or no attention to its consequences. And of course, losing its aspiration to be a more sustainable form of tourism, which is what I had initially claimed in 2005 in my book. And of course, one that would not reflect what Pollock calls it conscious travel. A more positive, inspiring, and compelling appeal to create a better, more stable, higher yielding form of tourism that delivers tangible and equitable benefit to all communities and cause all stakeholders to flourish. And indeed, what one would hope is that travellers' desire for authenticity, coupled with increasing awareness about the world system and the impact of the way we travel and, in a way, live in general, has led to niche tourism to play an important role in facilitating more conscious form of travel and tourism and ensuring the prospect for new generations. At least this is my hope and what I'm actively campaigning for. A growing number of academic and industry-led research points to an encouraging trend of socially and environmentally conscious hosts and travelers who employ tourism as a transformative medium to promote sustainable practice and consequently a more conscious living on our planet. In other words, increasingly, transformative travelers use their trip to reinvent themselves and the world they live in. Social scientists, economists, political activists, writers, spiritual leaders even, and many successful entrepreneurs claim that humanity is going through a 21st century paradigm shift, transforming from traditional or modern culture to new modern ways of living, based on a variable set of values and form the foundation of what is known the silent revolution. This is led by a growing number of alleged culture creatives, a concept brought to the fore in the year 2000 by Ray and Anderson. This is based on values associated with respect for the planet, human relationship, cooperation, peace, social justice, self-fulfillment, spirituality, and self-expression. Ray and Anderson categorize cultural creative lifestyle as experimental, authentic, and holistic. They recognize that new consumers would still want more, but they are defining what they want in a different way. They are no longer interested in large quantity of material goods, but rather they are very much keen on more meaningful and deep social connections, more substance, and a greater sense of purpose. It is in this context that whether by involving in conservation or by simply engaging in activities such as the tracking of gorilla, like you can see here in the photograph, the point is that there is an increasing need for conscious and transformative holidays as a trend where responsible traveling can provide the means to change both lifestyles as well as in increase the positive and caring impact made on destinations, whether on women empowerment, conservation, or poverty alleviation, which are very much the core of my work these days. Academic and sector-based research increasingly confirm this trend, and albeit using different terms to communicate the shift towards this new traveling mindset, what they do nothing more than actually confirming what is happening in other sectors. If you look at agriculture, with the biological agriculture, with a number of other fair trade principles that, in a way, we are exposed to every day increasingly, travel and tourism is certainly makes no difference to that. These terms are based on Atalevich frames this new way of seeing things as transmodern. Reisinger has transformative, Godwin called it responsible tourism, And as previously mentioned, Pollock refers to it as conscious travel. These terms are based on individual traveling to reconnect and in a way rediscover themselves. They seek meaningful experiences which help them develop personally and collectively, valuing what is slow, small, and simple, and may travel in order to make a difference, for example, by volunteering on a project. It is not a new thing that niche tourism has played a main facilitator in the implementation of alternative and possibly more responsible tourism practice. But now more than ever, it is playing a core role in allowing access to new experiences, transforming personal values, influencing professional aspirations, and shifting worldviews through educational, community-based, eco, farm, adventure, cultural, philanthropic, wellness, spiritual tourism, and we can continue. One would hope that this will influence the way change may increasingly come from the bottom up. However, this should be grounded in community, agency, and resilience. A system where tourism operates responsibly within a visitor economy that works for all. Take, for example, the operation based in Kenya, in Talek, Kenya, an operation called Base Camp Masai Mara, the first to have a Masai woman as their luxury camp manager against all cultural barriers. During their visit, visitors get to grasp the women what women empowerment is about. Their journey goes beyond the big five and is facilitated by women guides that go around the camp and the fields, guiding guests and teaching them about climate change, about strategies to adapt to the environmental droughts and problems that they face on a daily basis, and also things like alternative energy consumption and water use. These are women which have not gone to school, but they've actually had the opportunity to attend some of the local educational projects funded through philanthropic engagement by tourists. Basecamp Maasai brand, of which you can see photograph on the left, is an example where 118 women who would otherwise stay at home would actually get involved in creating and preparing the crafts that tourists would normally buy. Most tourists, in fact, are fascinated and buy Maasai beads products. Visitors have the opportunity to learn about the craft and how it's made by interacting with the very Maasai woman who made the bracelet or the keyring they will buy as a souvenir in the souvenir shop. Maasai brand showcases how recycling and reusing plastic and aluminium into craft products have become their daily practice. And as Agnes told me, tourism brings rubbish, and we have found a way to sell it back to them. The bottle of mosquito repellent just transformed into something that you will keep for life by your office keys. And indeed, you would think probably stops there. No, it doesn't. Sales continue when visitors get back home. I was one of them that had my Christmas tree decorated with Maasai decorations, just ordered online, because 80% of Basecamp Maasai brand are made via internet orders, reducing the risk associated with a volatile tourism industry. And Kenya, as you know, has not been spared from the drop in tourism arrivals due to terrorism lately. What is more is that their products have made it into the global retail supply chain and reached the shelves of Macy's in New York and the National Geographic shop in the Regent Street in London. So, notwithstanding the challenges of operating within the contested field of sustainable development, my most recent work addresses the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development by clearly rejecting the idea of a passive business-as-usual approach. Sustainable tourism is mentioned in the 2030 Agenda 4 times. However, the term is strongly contested by civil society organizations and academics for its lack of people-centered approach. Only tourism that actually contributes to the improvement of the well-being of local people, dignity of workers, environmental integrity, as well as the elimination of exploitation, inequalities, and poverty is a meaningful option for sustainable development. Let's stop for a second. When I talk about dignity of workers, only recently I found out that without thinking of countries in emerging or developing destination, if you look at the London hospitality industry, you will find out that actually there is no union representation for workers working for the hospitality industry. And I was introduced to one of the campaigners who is trying to develop that recently in Berlin when we were developing one of the recent project on transforming tourism. And so when I look beyond my doorsteps, it's easy to associate unsustainable practice. But when actually we look not far from where we live, it's even more challenging to even think that something like this is still happening in a developed context. So going back to the Agenda 2030, with the United Nations General Assembly declaring 2017 as the International Year of Sustainable Tourism for Development, recalling the potential of tourism to advance the universal 2030 agenda and its 17 sustainable development goals, it is expected that the importance of sustainable tourism will further showcase and understood. I'm not convinced about that. According to some, this has the potential to place sustainable tourism right at the heart of the agenda of many tour operators and inspire many more consumers. However, this may still be part of a merely commercially focused strategy to adapt to shifting market demand that we talked about earlier. As Paula clearly commented, transforming tourism may not be as easy as it looks, because many tour operators will find themselves operating in an economy and cultural transitioning between two very different paradigms. The current dominant model, the old story, based on the importance of number of tourists arrivals, economic growth, and money, as the primary sign of success. You need to speak to every minister of tourism in the world, and the first parameter used to measure success in tourism is how many more tourists we will be able to get in our country. And an emerging, obviously, the other paradigm is an emerging model that defines success in richer, qualitative terms associated with the development and well-being experienced by individuals, enterprises, communities, and the planet as a whole. My engagement in critical reflections on the connection between tourism and each of the 17 Sustainable Development Goals include my work with Bread for the World Tourism Watch for the realization of an online compendium on transforming tourism, for which Adam Jones and I wrote a chapter linked to the SDG 4 on the importance of inclusive and equitable quality education in tourism. I recently return from Berlin, where I was part to a collaboration amongst 30 civil society from 19 countries across South America, Africa, Asia, for the drawing of the Berlin Declaration on Transforming Tourism, which was presented 3 weeks ago at the IT trade fair in Berlin in front of an audience of business as much as government organization. These two projects have highlighted the modest socioeconomic or ecological adjustment in the current model of production and consumption of travel and tourism, which is usually associated with the term sustainable tourism. What we have concluded in our workshops and discussion that the current way sustainable tourism is promoted will not bring the necessary change and thus will fail to address both sustainability and development. As said, sustainability has guided much of my work. I've been committed to engaging in and facilitating research, teaching, and learning practices, which are by their very nature transformative and more conscious, operating in a sphere that today our university's research and enterprise strategy calls it responsible futures. For instance, I was researching, advising, and writing about sustainability, and I realized that one of the possibly most representative and potentially receptive audiences was at our doorsteps, our students. By adopting a research-led teaching approach, my objective became to inspire those who would become engaged in tourism, both as new generation of ambassadors and travelers. One would hope that they are best placed to steward sustainability and experience travel and tourism more responsibly once they graduated. Before I show you a short video made by our students, I would like to contextualize where this came from. Over the past 15 years of business and leisure travel around Africa, I recall departure lounges packed with flocks of volunteers and do-gooders, made of teenagers on gap years, senior citizens on a refund themselves mission, members of religious institutions and change makers wanting to do their bit. Students willing to travel off the beaten track or volunteer overseas, as well as people willing to give, do good, and change the world while traveling appear to me pretty much dramatically on the increase. But I came to the conclusion that the intention of doing good while traveling did not necessarily translate into actually doing well. In some cases, producing more harm than anybody could ever imagine. Of course, as Western traveling in less developed locations, and within Africa in particular, it is easy to be drawn into the desire of helping the less fortunate, as we are the product of stigmas, myths, and misconceptions promoted through the Make Poverty History campaign or the BBC comic relief Poverty Porn, with tattooed images of poverty and African children in despair. This is not to say that dire poverty is not persistent in some location in Africa, and I say in some location in Africa, or that images of suffering and destitution are not the most effective ways to raise money from a 30-second ad in response to an emergency. But the reality is that we, and I emphasize we, often fail miserably to even understand our role as privileged entities operating in an age where sustainability is an ultimate aspiration for some. What is worse is that we simply fail to grasp the implication of our individual actions while crossing unknown fields or indeed traveling into unknown lands. So, the story I'm about to share with you is the story of Peer to Peer International, by no means perfect. It is an example of our attempt to do things differently and responsibly, facilitating transformation through tourism for those that one day will become the next generation of travel and tourism experts.
Five-star music. In money.
Peer-to-peer capacity building through tourism is a program we've been running since 2007. As part of the University of Brighton School of Sport and Service Management, our students have the opportunity to visit the Gambia every year as part of a training program whereby an average of 20 international students visit the Gambia in working collaboration with 10 to 15 Gambian participants. Since 2007, we've been very privileged to collaborate with Sandeli Eco Retreat and Learning Center in providing the opportunity to a number of young learners on how to use tourism as a way to engage with local communities and actually create business opportunities, which have then translated into real business entrepreneurial engagement here in the Gambia. Peer-to-peer capacity building initiative includes a number of training activities, from seminars to presentations to group activities, all aimed and having a peer-to-peer exchange and mutual cross-cultural understanding of what it means to operate in different economic contexts.
The peer-to-peer, it's been just such a gift to be able to watch this whole thing unfold over a number of years. It's what started off as what we thought were dreams coming true with the first group arrival 9 years ago. Now it's really getting to the point where it's solid projects that are already underway, being enhanced by the opportunity for people to focus and have the input from the academic side, from the Brighton students, and the Brighton students actually being exposed to the realities on the ground.
Turtle SOS The Gambia is an example of engagement whereby our student built upon engagements of Sandeli Eco Retreat and Learning Center with communities along the People's Coast, a stretch of 27 kilometers, whereby communities from 5 different villages have come together to conserve and preserve the lives of many turtles nesting on the Gambia beach.
My name is Maredu Gambi, I'm from Katong.
Yeah. My name is Esidumane, I'm from Katong.
My name is Musa Jaite, I am from Katong.
No, before this course last year, I was staying at home doing nothing. I have a lot of experience which I never have had before.
Last year, we have been to many places like Combo Beach, to Manitenda, where I have never been before. So after this course, we gathered together. We don't want to separate, we gathered as a group.
Since last year, we have really achieved a lot. And since then, we decided to stick together to make basis of what we achieved from the University of Brighton.
After the course, we didn't want to separate. So we decided that we said we have to remain together. What can we do to stay together?
So last year, during our courses with our university students, we went to Combo Beach. That's where we saw this juice bar. And I think those people who are doing this, they got a lot of income from them, from it. This is why we also plan to do this.
The program for English tourism was the best experience I had in the University of Brighton. it pointed me in the right direction with what I really wanted to do in my future. Not only that, but it gave me great personal and professional development. I also made fantastic friends out in Gambia and experiences that I'll remember for a lifetime.
I totally fell in love with Gambia. I found amazing friends for my lifetime, and I expanded my experience in a, not only in a professional way, where it's responsible tourism, community-based tourism, but I also expanded my personal experience.
So I believe together we will rise, renew, stronger and united, because this is our time, our chance to get back to the best which we are, to lead by example with dignity, integrity and honor that built our community and that built Brighton University. So I'm thanking everyone for contributing towards the development and anyone who contributed towards the success of this gathering and this wonderful achievement. So I'm thanking everyone.
So, during the past 10 editions of the Peer-to-Peer International, we've had over 200 University of Brighton students, over 100 Gambian participants sponsored by our alumni programs, and I would say probably about over 2,000 young learners that have benefited from the peer-to-peer and by being exposed both to the unique learning opportunities, but most importantly, having the chance to champion our students, to be peers to our students, even if they never went to school, because their knowledge was certainly what made the experience far more valuable for us as lecturers, but most importantly, for us as learners, because I never stopped learning. Peer-to-peer has operated in line with the University of Brighton commitment to widening participation and sustainable development in its broader meanings. Philanthropic donation by student of as little as £25 added to the field trip cost have enabled the sponsorship of our Gambian counterparts, adding value and experience to all those involved, staff and students. We've been able to facilitate mutually beneficial educational exchanges and share knowledge about sustainable, niche, and responsible business principles and practices, and remove some of the stigmas, myths, and misconception about travel and tourism to destination within Africa. Our past participants have clearly told us that this is what has made a huge difference to them personally and professionally, far beyond tourism. And as Simon Gibber, the chair of Sandeli Foundation, told us, over the past 10 years, there have been a number of micro enterprises which have emerged and proliferated in their locality. Turtle SOS the Gambia, Sandeli Craft Experience, Kartong Riverside and Oyster Processing, as much as the juice presses. These are only a few examples. We've managed to grasp the principles of niche business development, and we've taken these forward with the help of a number of other educational programs run following the same principle of Peer-to-Peer International. The value of Peer-to-Peer International has taken a new high for me when, during my latest visit to the country, I was approached by two of our Gambian alumni who claimed that peer-to-peer had given them the reason to stay in the country and avoid risking their lives by going the back way to Europe. And I think there is not much to add to that. For those of you who don't know, the Gambia is the second country after Nigeria for number of migrants crossing the Med. And with the exception that while Nigeria's got over 150 million people living in the country, effectively the Gambia's got only 2 million. So to you, the conclusions. I would like to conclude by saying that my academic journey, because as I said at the beginning, this is about my journey, has been multifaceted and fascinating. Indeed, at times, very challenging. Some have defined my journey eclectic, opportunistic. Others, the more positive one, proactively creative and inspiring. What is more important to me, though, is that I've spent the past 20 years working on issues I'm deeply passionate about. I feel privileged as I have the opportunity to learn something every day from my peers as much as from my students. I research in some of the most unique settings and work with some of the most inspiring people one could ever wish for. And when I sit on those beach deck chairs, I rarely feel like an expert, but I often think of those days when I scroll down the globe that my father, Professor Giovanni, had in the corner of his office and dreamt of my next destination. I was about 4. I also think of the journey that took me here today, and I acknowledge the fact that what I have achieved would not have been possible without the emotional support, the critical eyes, and the inspirational presence in my life of some very special people. In particular, I'm grateful to, indeed, my father, Professor Giovanni, who set me on this academic path, and my mom, who challenged me on the need of saving the gorillas of Uganda or the turtles of West Africa, and patiently followed my travel on the world atlas and often wondered on the, and here I quote, necessity to travel to countries that any other mentally sane person would simply avoid. I would like also to thank Hannah Mercerly, Judy Caffergona, and Tricia Barnett for their inspiring views and critical advice. My former student, Catherine Gebert, for introducing me to the African continent through Namibia in 2003. Jerry Mitchell and Maurice Phillips and the community of Kautong in the Gambia for the continued inspiration they provide to me and to my students, and indeed my colleagues who are joining the party these days. All the African voices that made a huge difference to my profession. My colleagues who went out of their ways to support me by stepping into my classroom when Marina was traveling some obscure destinations. And in particular, I would like to thank my mentors, Jackie O'Reilly, Professor Jackie O'Reilly, and Professor Andrew Church, as much as a lot of other colleagues like Vicky Johnson's, Adam Jones, Graham Spacey, and Merce O'Hare within this university, or people like Rosalind Duffy, Professor Rosalind Duffy, and Claudia Dolezal in other universities. My student, indeed, need to be acknowledged because they made all I do far more worth the effort. My friends who stood by me, indeed, with sometimes with less orthodox ways of keeping me sane and motivated at some of the most challenging times in my life. The event department for organizing this event and for making sure that I got my University of Bari gown, surprisingly. And last but not least, the University of Brighton for allowing me to continue professing what I'm passionate about, in case you didn't notice, by including responsible futures into our new research and enterprise strategy, to which I'm looking forward to make an active contribution. So, I would like to leave you this evening by actually saying, next time you end up sitting on that beach deck chair, think, are you the expert? And whatever the answer, please remember, don't forget to enjoy the journey. Thank you very much.